Hey, I'm Thomas from Speckle, and today I'm going to show you how to use Speckle in Grasshopper. Now, today I'm going to assume you have a pretty good level of knowledge of how to use Grasshopper, and we're also going to assume that you already have a Speckle account, and you have Rhino, and the Speckle connector downloaded and installed. So, let's stop talking and get started. So with Speckle in Grasshopper, there's three really distinct stages that we have to think about. The first is loading our Speckle model into Grasshopper. The second is augmenting that Speckle model within Grasshopper, querying it and editing that data. And then the third is publishing that model back onto Speckle. So today we're going to go through each stage, but these stages don't necessarily have to be in this order. It just makes sense for today that we bring in an existing Revit model into Grasshopper so we can kind of start querying and seeing how that model is organized in terms of its data structure. And we can explain all of that today. We're going to explain how to query it and to edit that data, and then finally just publish that back up onto Speckle. So let's get started and have a look how to load that data into Grasshopper. So there's three slightly different ways that we can load a Speckle model into Grasshopper. The first way here is using the Speckle model URL node. And what this does is it asks for your workspace, which is the first line here. And you can see I've got a few different workspaces. Typically, you'll probably only have one, so you can just click on the workspace that you want to be in. And then it's going to ask you to select a project. So we can come down and we have a Revit project here that we want to use. So let's click that. And then the third option is it's going to ask for a model. So within that project, we have two models, but we're just going to click the Revit model example here. And then finally, it's going to ask for a version. It defaults to the latest version, so we can just click on that. So now we have a model link coming out of this node here. We can have a look at that by connecting this panel. You don't normally have to look at this, but it's just to show what's coming out of it. And then we're connecting that to a load node here, which you can find up here in the Speckle panel. All you have to do is click load, and that will bring it down from the Speckle servers. Now, that's going to load into Rhino. Well, the preview is going to load into Rhino. And you can see it here. It's your typical Grasshopper, slightly beige, not beige, red-ish, wine-colored preview. And that's just showing you that it's coming in successfully. So that's the first way of bringing a Speckle model into Grasshopper. The second way is you can pass a link directly into the Speckle model URL node, and this will transform it so it's applicable to this load node here. So now we have our model in Grasshopper. All we need to have a look at is how that data is coming in and how we can edit it. So a Speckle model comes into Grasshopper as a Speckle collection. This is sort of our way of handling the way different programs have different attitudes towards layers. So for instance, Rhino has layers, but Revit doesn't. So we have to have a sort of way that we can translate those models between applications that do and don't have layers or varying attitudes towards those layers. So all models get transformed into a Speckle collection, which for the sake of this project, you can really assume it's essentially layers. And you can start looking at what that looks like by using the expand collection node. It gives you an idea of the parents and the children of each of that tree structure. So here you can see this model has two parents that are named the same. But once we expand down further, we can see that the Revit model is actually divided up into levels. And if we connect this Speckle collection node here, we can actually start querying and seeing what each of those collections looks like. So you can see the 1F collection here contains all of the geometry associated with 1F, and so on. So you can kind of get an idea that the Speckle collection is essentially a layer structure. It really depends how that model has been imported, what program it was authored in, and how we handle those layers. So now that we understand what a collection is, we can start having a look at Speckle objects. So within each collection is a bunch of Speckle objects. And to have a look at what these look like, we can again just take that Speckle collection that we're bringing in and use this query objects node here. And what this does is it takes the collection and breaks it up into individual Speckle objects, which we can see in this panel here. We have all of our Speckle objects coming in. What we can do then is we can pass it through into a Speckle object node. And this is sort of used to either create Speckle objects or to actually just break them down a little bit and to see the different properties. So we can see each Speckle object has a name. It also will have other properties depending on where that object is coming from. And a little advanced here is we have within the dev node, this deconstruct node. And what this does is it breaks down that Speckle object into its fundamental parts. So you can see you can access the vertices and the faces and the colors and etc. of that Speckle object in case you need access to those kind of fundamental building blocks of that geometry. So moving on, we can actually start querying our Revit model using regex. Now, regex is sort of a big topic and quite complicated, but for now, I'll just show a really simple use of regex. So here we're bringing in, again, that Speckle collection, and we're using this node called collection selector. What this lets us do is select collections, but up here, what it has is a really cool feature where we can use a question mark and go door. And what that will do is filter out all of the collections that don't have the word door in it. Now, you need to know that this is case sensitive, and also that this is regex. So you can do much more complex queries here. But for today's tutorial, we're just going to go with question mark door. And essentially what that's doing is it's not showing anything that doesn't have door in it. So what we can do is actually just start selecting objects that are here now. And you can see that it gives you a little tick. And what this means is it's passing this data into query objects. And if we preview this, we can see we have all of our doors in this project highlighted and filtered. This is a really, really cool and powerful component, but regex is sort of a bigger topic, and maybe we'll do another tutorial later explaining the full potential of that query. So the next thing we can do is query by object name. So we just have the Speckle collection coming in. What we're doing is breaking those collections down into objects, and then bringing them into this new component, filter objects. This node takes a few different properties, but for this example, we're just passing in this text, which is a name of a particular component within our Revit model. And what this does is it splits it out into two lists. So objects that meet that criteria. So if we preview, we can see we have one object that meets that criteria, and then also the objects that don't meet that criteria. So those go into the second list. So that's kind of a really quick way to start filtering or splitting your objects into separate lists. So the final thing I'll show here is how do we query for values on our properties. So it's a pretty common workflow that you might want to filter out a list of volumes that meet a certain criteria. So how do we do that? So all we have to do is take in the Speckle collection. We deconstruct it into a list of objects using the query objects node. And we're using a new node here called property selector. We're using a regex here to filter out all the properties that aren't description. So here we're just going to click on this to send this property to yet another node called query properties. Now what query properties does is it takes a key, which is this, and it takes the objects that we deconstructed before, and it gets you the value of those properties. So if we attach a panel to the output of this, a lot of these will be empty because they don't have any values, but you can see that we have the identity data description value on some of these. So you can see ALU composite single door with sidelight. So what we can do from there is just typical Grasshopper workflow using a match text node here. We want to find all the objects that have the property of tree on them. We can use that to then cull pattern. And then finally, you'll have your objects that have been filtered out. So if we click on preview, you can see we have all of our trees because that's what they are. So that gives you a really good idea of how the Speckle model is structured and how you can sort of interact with it in Grasshopper. So moving on, we're going to look at how we can edit this data and also upload that data onto Speckle. Okay, so we've filtered out our objects that we want to modify, and we want to re-upload those onto Speckle with some changes to the properties. So this is really easy to do. So we can see that we have our Speckle objects coming in. What we'd want to do is use this Speckle object node that we showed previously. And what we're going to do is we're just going to add a new property called the answer, and the value of it is going to be 42. So here it's not super obvious, but the name that you provide here is the name of the property. And you can always add more properties by zooming in and clicking the plus sign on your node. We're also passing in a new color, which is fluoro pink. So this is creating a modified list of Speckle objects, which we can see using this panel. What we want to do is now reconstruct those into a collection, because that's what we need to upload back onto Speckle. So all we have to do is use the create collection node. And again, here you can see that if you zoom in, you can add additional collections to this node. And just note that the way you name the inputs to these nodes is how that collection is going to be named. So this is creating our collection from these Speckle objects. And all we need to do is publish that onto Speckle. So how do we do that? Well, there's two sort of separate ways we can do that. One is a manual way. It's sort of very similar to the way we loaded that model in. We need the Speckle model URL node, and we need to pass that into a publish node. This requires you to hit publish for that data to actually appear. So you can kind of see the logical pattern here. When you load models in, you sort of have to deconstruct them down from their collection into the objects. And then if you want to re-upload them onto Speckle, you have to reconstruct that structure, that data structure, back in reverse. And the same is true if you're doing it the other way around. So thank you for bearing with me, and happy speckling.